Welcome back.
Today the experiment that we are seeing is single phase semi converter. What is the difference between semi converter and full converter? Full converter is having four thyristors, whereas here the semi converter you are seeing only two. Okay, this need not be arranged in the same fashion, but you have alternate topologies. Like you can have both the thyristors on one leg, both the diodes on one leg. This could be a possible topology of a semi converter. Similarly, I can exchange the way the thyristors are positioned. I can put it down. So this is the way also. So both the bottom legs are thyristors here, top legs are diodes. This is also one of the possible configuration. Here you are seeing thyristors this side. I can exchange both the thyristors here, diodes here. That is also one possible topology. And like this, alternate topologies of semiconductors can be arranged. What is the advantage? When you look at, when all the four are thyristors in a full converter, we need to use four triggering pulse generation circuits, right? So the complexity is more. And you can replace now two thyristors means the firing complexity is reduced. Diodes are definitely more cheaper than the thyristors. That way you can save on the you can get a bit compact device. Apart from that, one more advantage. When a system has some advantages, there should be some disadvantage. What is disadvantage? When you are having a reversible kind of operation, when you want to reverse the supply from the load to the source, if you want to send, in that case, if it is a thyristor, it is possible. All the four are thyristors, it is possible. Otherwise, no. In semiconductor operation, reversible power supply is not possible. So, that is the limitation. So, as long as you are obtaining from the source to the load a controlled rectification kind of operation, a semiconductor will solve the purpose as good as a full converter. So, let us see the performance of semiconductor with respect to R load. Here, if only resistance is a load, there is no difference in the operation. At the triggering angle alpha, when Q1 is triggered, you have here output visible across the load. And pi, the thyristor T1 stops conduction because of its natural characteristics. The, what is the path? Path is from the source to the thyristor T1, to the ammeter, to the load, and V2 and back. So what you are seeing is T1, V2 is the conduction path. Next, when here the supply is getting the negative half cycle, what is going to happen? Here anode will get negative. So this particular thyristor stops conduction. The thyristor stops conduction, the alternate path will be from the supply to T2. Now how is T2 biased? Now, when the supply is, the negative half cycle is approaching here, T1 anode is reverse biased, so what is going to happen? This is positively biased and T2 gets positive, right? T1 gets negative, T2 gets positive. When T2 gets positive, T2 starts the conduction, the flow of the path is something like this. So, from the supply to the T2, ammeter, load. Now, instead of V2, D1 starts conduction. You have the path like this. Right? So, always the direction through the resistance is, direction of flow of current is, this is positive, this is negative. So, there is no reversal across the load. So, you are seeing the next pair with T2, D1, then again it will become T1, D2, then again it will become T2, D1. So that is with respect to RO. Well, so there is no difference either semi converter or full converter when you are trying to do with RO, right? Then when you are having an RL load, what is going to happen? There's an inductor, so there's an inductor which is getting added. When the inductor is there in the circuit, what will happen? When the thyristor was supposed to turn off at pi, okay, the inductor polarity is getting reversed, so this is charging positive here, negative here. It will not allow the original diode D2 to stop conduction. So the conduction proceeds. There's a delay. So that's what you are going to see here. This is with respect to RL and this is with respect to RO. Right? So there's an extension in the commutation till the energy stored in the inductor dissipates. It's going over through the resistance, it's going on into conduction, and after that only it will stop its conduction. So this is what is happening. What is the net resultant net effect with RL load? Whatever the average DC that is appearing because of this negative spike, you are getting output voltage getting reduced. So that's a disadvantage. So to avoid that, what we are doing is we are connecting a diode known as freewheeling diode. We will be connecting a device, a diode known as freewheeling diode. What does a freewheeling diode do? It provides an alternate path for the flow. Right? The moment this is positive, this is also positive. So instead of the conduction proceeding to D2, what it will do? It will go through this freewheeling diode and you will see that this is the path. So till the energy stored in the inductor dissipates in the load resistance, you have the circulation over here happening and the waveform will be finally the same as your the freewheeling diode, the waveform across the output resistance. Though it is RL load, it is going to follow the same way as your RO, right? So that's what is the behavior with respect to freewheeling diode, that is the advantage of freewheeling diode. In the class we have discussed general purpose diodes, fast recovery diodes, Schottky diodes, right? So this is the fourth type. This is a freewheeling diode. The application is mostly used in inductive loads. Now, instead of RL load, you can connect a motor here because that's what is our experiment about. So we have here motor terminals. Okay, when we are connecting a motor, we'll be seeing that as the variation on output voltage occurs, there is a variation in the speed, right? Your V is directly proportional to N. As you increase the output voltage, as you increase the input to the motor, applied voltage, definitely there is an increase in speed. So, by varying firing angle, you are able to achieve a speed control. So, that's what is a practical demonstration of today's experiment that we are going to see in the conduction. See the behavior of the semi converter with RL load. Here the triggering angle is 180 degree now. As expected, output average DC output voltage is 0 and you are seeing a 0 there. Now please make the triggering angle to 150 degree. 150 degree triggering angle. You are seeing output average DC output voltage rising to 1 volt. And here you are seeing the inductor behavior. You can see instead of terminating at 180, it is extending to a negative thing. Then there are some oscillation before it is actually dying down. So this is the thing. Now please change it to 120 degree. The output average DC output voltage has risen to 6 and you see that
pretty much neat. So you can see at 120 degree, right? 120 degree triggering angle, the behavior of the inductance, which is not allowing the voltage to the device to turn off. So it is extending the commutation, and there's the ripple that is seen being seen there. Now the DC output hold, the firing triggering angle is being changed to 90 degree. The output, the DC voltage has risen to 13 volts, and you are seeing, I will make it paused so you can see it clearly, the behavior of the inductance of the system, inductance on the system. Okay. वोल्टेज नहीं वेरी होता है इसका, इससे सो प्रिटी मच नीट वे फॉर्म. सो यू आर सी 90 डिग्री है ना, 90 फॉर 90 डिग्री द द कंडक्शन, हाउ द इंडक्टेंस इज कॉजिंग अ नेगेटिव रिपल. सो 60 degree output voltage is 19 volts, near to 19 volts, and I'll just run the waveform again. So this is a 60 degree circuit. You can see the behavior, it's pretty much neat, right? So make it to 30 degree. 21 volts, 22 volts. I'll run it again, the DSO waveform. So you are seeing the behavior for 30 degree, you know. So that negative spike, whatever is occurring there, pretty much simple. And zero. So you are seeing output has risen to 626 volts, and finally. Almost it's like a the effect of thyristor is not there over there. It's just behaving like a pulsating, like a full bridge diode rectifier. Pulsating DC is what you are seeing, but you are also seeing that some sort of oscillations. That's because of the small inductance which is there in the system. Okay, so this behavior we are eliminating using a freewheeling diode that is shown subsequently. Thank you. See what is the effect of freewheeling diode here. Freewheeling diode is a diode DM that is written over there. What we did was we have connected anode of it to the negative terminal, cathode of it to the positive. It's like we have connected it in reverse. Okay. So now the triggering angle is 180 degree. Output is zero and you are not seeing any pulse. Now please change the triggering angle to 150 degree. Output is has risen to 2 volts and you are seeing a clean neat waveform. You are not seeing inductance ripple which has occurred previously when you are using a RL load. See here, so inductor is there in the system, but you are not seeing the effect of inductance in reducing the output voltage, right? So that's the advantage of freewheeling diode. The other day in class I was discussing you about four different types of diodes, right? General purpose diode, rectifying diode, Schottky diodes, and freewheeling diodes. So this is a freewheeling diode. So now output volt free triggering angle is increased to 120 degree. You are seeing 6 volts and then a neat waveform. Please change it to 90 degree triggering angle. And 13 volts is appearing across the output, and a 90 degree neat waveform. Can understand? So here inductance is there in the system as part of RL load, but still you are seeing effect of inductance mitigated because of the freewheeling diode that we are seeing there, right? So please change it to 60 degree now. Output voltage has increased VDC to 20 volts. We are seeing a very clear, clean, neat waveform. of 60 degree triggering angle, how it looks like. Please change it to 30 degree. So 23 volts and the waveform with 30 degree triggering angle. Average DC output voltage has risen to 24 volts. Make it zero. Volts as expected, and now you are just seeing full wave rectifier output. There's no effect of any thyristor there because triggering angle is zero, and just you are seeing the conventional rectifier, bridge rectifier output. So by this way you can vary the output DC voltage of a system. When you are seeing DC here, it is a pulsating DC. If you want to filter it, you have to put a capacitive filter. The design of it and all, again, we'll be discussing subsequently later. As of now, our intention is only to show you the pulsating DC. If we want to eliminate the pulsating DC and make it a constant, we have to put a capacitive filter in the system. Right? So this is the experiment. So today we are seeing a motor speed control experiment using a semiconverter. This is one of the experiment as part of your syllabus. Okay. So what is the difference between semiconverter and full converter configuration that you are seeing? Down, just look at it. Now we are connected to the diodes D2 and D4 rather than the thyristors T1 dash and T2 dash. So that is the only difference. And now here, instead of all the four firing pulses being taken, we are taking only two, which are connected actually to the upper arms of T1 and T2. So that's the only difference. So it's just connected as per the diagram, circuit diagram, with T1 and D2 in one leg, and T2 and D4 in one leg. Upper arms are shorted and then connected to the ammeter. From the ammeter, it goes to the voltmeter. Motor is connected across parallelly to the voltmeter, and then the field winding of the DC motor, it is given to the field. So that's the way the circuit diagram gets completed. Now let us start the experiment. You can just note it down. 180 degree, it's just showing 0 or 1, it's just nothing. Now please reduce the triggering angle to 150 degree, and let us see how the output responds. So the output voltage had become around 10 volts. The current is 0.05 amperes. This is the current drawn by the motor. Please note down the tachometer reading. So this is a tachometer. Gives us the speed recording. It shows to be around 58.8 RPM. So 58.9, it is oscillating between that. 58.9 RPM. Now please reduce the triggering angle to 120 degree. Enough. Now see the output voltage, it has risen to 71 volts, and then current has increased to 0.14 amperes. And just try to recollect the ratings of this particular motor. It's around 220 volts rated. At the peak current is 2.3 amperes. That's what we need to know. And here speed is 499.1 and 504. Between that it's oscillating. Let us take it as 504. So previously how much was the speed? 58.9, and now it had become 504 RPM. Now please reduce the triggering angle to 90 degree using the decrement function of the it is, and see the current voltage 125 volts, current 0.15 amperes, and let us see what is the speed now. 907 RPM. So that's what is the speed. Just look at the rated speed of this particular device. It is around 1500 RPM, which we are not supposed to go beyond that. That's what we have to monitor. And 220 volts is applied, and here we have connected at 110, so no issue. The current is okay. So let us reduce the triggering angle further to 60 degree. Enough, 60 degree. Now see what is the output voltage, 145 volts, and the current is around 0.15 amperes. So a lot of noise being produced. You can see that how the wire is shaking there because of the noise disturbance. See how much is the speed now, 1060 rpm. Can we go to 30 degree? Just try it out. If it changes, we'll do. Otherwise, we'll stop here. Yes, it's responding. 30 degree now. Right. And the voltage is 147 volts. Current is 0.15 amperes. And then speed is 1084 rpm. Let us make it zero triggering angle. The last reading, so zero it's now. 147 volts, 0.15 amperes. Current is not changing much. Voltage is also not changed much. Probably speed also might not have changed. Could have reached some sort of saturation kind of thing. Let us see. No change. 1078, 1084, the same range. It is oscillating. Fine. Okay. Thank you. So this is what is the experiment all about. What we have seen, just look at the diagram of switch off. Just see. So 180 degree, applied voltage is 0, speed is also 0. 150, voltage has become 9, speed has become 58.9 rpm, and at 30 degrees the voltage had become 147 and the speed has become 1084 rpm. Okay, so this is the way that tabulation readings can be taken, and once the recording is done, you can plot the characteristics of the motor with triggering angle versus the speed, right? Triggering angles versus the output voltage as can be plotted, speed also can be plotted, and that could become your recording. And the theoretical practical verification also can be done. So this is all about the experiment of the semi converter speed control of DC motor using a semi converter configuration. Same thing can be done with full converter, no issue, except that the two diodes has to be replaced by two thyristors, right? I hope it is interesting to you. Thanks a lot.